Today, we're going to do something a little bit different. A lot of people have been asking how to connect to their 3D printer boards via Wi-Fi. And the solutions vary. So I wanted to show you something that'll work with all of them. And the solution that I found was the Raspberry Pi 4 that you can connect using the software OctoPrint. So I'm going to show you how to set that up today, but just as a reminder, I need to let you know that I purchased all of the equipment with my own money, and no one is paying me or sponsoring me to do this tutorial, but I will be placing Amazon affiliate links in the description to help you find these products better. So if you haven't noticed, I've already set up the Raspberry Pi 4 in its case. I'll put a link in the description, like I said before, but I need to point out a couple of things. Our power comes through this little connection here, and then we're going to be running the USB off of one of the USB ports on the left-hand side. Now, the other thing that I need to point out on this is that it keeps a hard drive that runs off an SD drive. So I'm using an 8 gigabit hard drive in order to do this. And in order for me to program it, I'm going to need to use a SanDisk adapter in order to plug this into my computer to copy the ISO image onto the drive. So the first thing you need to do, obviously, is put it in the adapter and make sure that the drive is not set to write protected. So now we're going to put this in the computer, and you may hear a beep. Okay, now that we have the drive installed for the micro SD, you may need to format it. Mine's already formatted, as you can see, but in order to format it, you're going to right-click, you're going to go to Format, and over here, the filing system that you want to use is FAT32. Doesn't really matter what the volume name is or label. So you can click start and that'll take care of it for you. But seeing how mine's already done, we're going to ignore that for now. So we're going to go over to our web browser and we're going to type OctoPrint. And we're going to be looking for the download. So we're going to go to the OctoPrint website. And in here, they have a bunch of different tabs that you can choose from, being the blog, the forum, download, donate, merchandise, plugins, and probably even more. There's even a wiki. But we're going to go to download. And then down here, what we have is the download that we want to download. So we're going to click on this. And this may take a few moments to download. So I'll pause the video for a second and then show you what we're going to do when it's complete. Okay, now that we have downloaded OctoPi, we need to extract this. So I'm going to right click on it and go to extract all and click the extract button. Now while that's extracting, I want to show you that in some cases, if you have a hidden Wi-Fi for your SSID, then you're going to need to add this line right here, which is scan underscore SSID equals 1 to your WPA or WPA2 secure network. And I'll show you how to do that in just... So now that we have it actually unzipped, we need to use an imager. So I'm going to use down here what's known as the Raspberry Pi imager. I'll include a link in the description. So I'm going to open this up. I'm going to choose the file. So I'm going to scroll down to the bottom where it says use custom. I'm then going to find the directory by going to my downloads directory. I'm going to open up the OctoPrint and I'm going to click on the image file. Then I'm going to click open. Then I'm going to choose the SD drive, which is right here, and I'm going to click write. Now this may take a few minutes, so we'll let this run for a second. Okay, now that it's completed, what you need to do is first click continue, then close out of this, then remove the SD adapter for a second, then place it back into the computer. And then what we're going to do is we're going to navigate down through the files, and we need to make a change to our Octi WPA-supplicant file. So we're going to open that up. I'm going to expand this out, but actually, I'm going to open this in Notepad++ to avoid any issues when we edit it. So I'm going to scroll down and find WPA and WPA2. And I'm going to remove the comments, which are these pound signs. Okay, so now it's enabled, but we need to know what our SSID is. So we're going to go over to our browser. And currently, I have my router up in front of us, and it says your SSID. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to actually copy this, and I'm going to go back and I'm going to paste that between the quotes because that's the name of our router in this case. And then our password in this case is going to be password. So I'm going to copy that and I'm going to paste the password in between these quotes right here. So that'll take care of being able to connect to the router. So we're going to click save over here. We're going to close out of this and we're going to insert this into the Raspberry Pi 4. So I'm going to remove the SD card now. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to take the micro SD out of the adapter and I'm going to place it inside the Raspberry Pi 4. I'm going to turn this over and I'm going to orient it so that we can actually plug in the power supply. Now, the good thing about this setup for the link that I'm going to leave in the description for the affiliate link is it will allow you to connect your devices easily without having to shop around for parts because they're all in one kit. So I'm going to connect it right here. And then there's a power switch that I'm going to click to actually activate this. I just have to get my hand on it. So now it's going to power up. And this is going to take a moment. So what we're going to do is we're going to connect the USB over here. And we're going to connect the other end right here on the Creality for the Ender 3. Now it may power your fan, don't panic, that's just power coming from your 5-volt power supply for your Raspberry Pi. And it's causing your fan that runs on 5 volts to actually activate as well as your LCD panel. Okay, now that we've given the Raspberry Pi a few moments, being a few minutes to actually boot up. I'm back on the browser for my router, so I'm gonna scroll down to where it says connected devices and click on that and see if it appears. So as you can see, it does say that the OctoPi is present. So we're going to copy this address right here for 192.168.2.3 and we're going to paste that into a new tab on our web browser and we're going to press enter. Now it's going to bring up the OctoPrint web interface and we need to configure it. So what I'm going to do is I'm obviously going to read through this kind of quick. It says, thank you for installing OctoPrint. This wizard is used to guide you through the final steps to getting your OctoPrint instance all set up and ready to go. We'll get you printing in no time. So I'm going to click next. And obviously there's some stuff they want us to set up. So we're going to call this OctoPrint 1 because I have it buffered. And I'm going to put in password for the password. And then for confirm password, I'm going to put in password again. And I'm going to go down to the bottom, see if there's anything else. It says, let's see, either disable access control or keep access control enabled. I'm just going to keep it enabled in my case. Yours may vary. Then I'm going to click next. And let's see, anonymous tracking, I'm not really into that. So I'm going to say disable and I'm going to say next. And then configure the connectivity check. This is all pretty much default for you. So we're going to enable connectivity check. And we're going to click next. And then finally, it says blacklisted processing. So what we're going to do is we're going to disable the plugin for blacklists because we're not actually using those. That could be something that you want to try, but in my case, I really don't care. So I'm going to go next. And then we're going to leave this as default. But what we're going to do is we're going to look at the print bed and build volume. So it's a rectangular or square print bed in our case. And the origin's going to be in the left-hand side for us, but you know, you have the chance to change it if you like. There is a heat bed. We don't have a heat chamber on the ender, so we're not going to worry about that. And we're going to say that it's 200 millimeters by 200 millimeters by, I think it's something like 250. So we'll do that, and then we're just going to click next. Then we'll go back to default printers to check one thing here. So accesses, we're not going to mess with this. This is something that you had to be rather experienced to work with. And then hot ends and extruders, we are using a 0.4 millimeter extruder on the Ender by Creality. So we're going to leave that alone, and we only have one extruder. So we're going to go next again. And it says it's all done. So we're going to click finished. And so here's the interesting part now. So now that we got this set up, we're going to connect to it. And what we're going to do is we're going to experiment with the temperature to see if we can turn it on. So I'm going to say 50 degrees Celsius and click the checkbox. And right now, the temperature is being raised to 50 degrees, as you can see with this line right here. And then what I want to do is try and control it. What I'm going to do is I'm going to move 10 steps in the X carriage direction. So I moved a couple of steps. Now I'm going to home everything so you can see that that works. Now you have to home Z separately, so I'm going to click right here. Now the cool thing about this is you can actually change the number of moves down below here with 1/10 of a millimeter, 1 millimeter, 10 millimeters, or 100. So we're going to try 100 for the Y direction to see how that works out. And that worked out pretty good. So if you like my tutorial, please press the like button and subscribe. And thank you for your time.